I'd like to introduce Andy and Lana Wachowski.
I'll sit here.
I can sit in the middle. That'd be kind of cool.
Maybe I'll sit over there. I'm gonna check my email.
Right. Well, you can use his phone. So what this is going to be is a little more freeform. I mean, we've been doing these things for a few years. Sometimes we have kind of a plan. Let's talk about your history and how did you break into the business and all this kind of stuff. And we might touch on that kind of stuff. But there's a lot more to film than just the business. And these are two artists that have done some pretty damn groundbreaking stuff. And I think the topic that we really want to kind of get out to everybody is stuff that I don't think you think about enough, and I'm guilty of it too, is aesthetics and film aesthetics. And the art of film, right? I mean, because
everybody
it is.
Everybody leaves.
right. Well, yeah, right. Let's talk about
how
Keanu
do I make
Reeves.
Millions?
Yeah, right. And these are two people that, have done it their way, which is amazing in a market-driven medium like film. I mean, it's amazing. It's amazing. And the impact, I was talking to them the other day, the impact that you both have had on film, it's astonishing to me. You know, when you grow up and you're a kid and you're watching these movies and you think, wow, I want to be a movie maker. I love movies so much. And then you learn about the history of film and you have this timeline in your head of, oh, and, you know, Méliès and Orson Welles and this timeline. And you're on the timeline. I mean, you're actually on this timeline. And it's amazing. So, and you haven't compromised. And I think that's where we should start the conversation. Film aesthetics and what is it about film, how did it draw you? What was it about this medium? Would you be working in a different medium if you had the opportunity? Or what was it, why was it film that was the medium for you to express yourself? What an awesome question, that, Matt.
It's got everything in it, Matt.
I know,
you've
right?
You've done it.
Yes. Good night.
We kind of thought we would start with writing. We loved we were gonna be writers, either writers of comic books or writers of novels. We loved
radio.
We were thinking radio
plays.
Really,
the future. We were thinking of radio. we liked telling stories. We liked ideas. Principally, our mom was an artist, so we grew up sort of aware of art and aesthetics, and we talked about aesthetics in relationship to movies. My parents loved movies, they love movies. And we went to movies constantly. That's the first thing. Like, when I was your age, basically, I saw every single solitary movie that was out. I would go through the newspaper, I would circle them, and I would like figure out a plan on how I would go and see them all. And it's amazing to me when I meet people who are like, oh yeah, I want to be in filmmaking, but they don't go see movies anymore. And I'm like, well, okay. It's like,
you should teach
I want to be a writer, but I don't really like books.
Yeah. You should teach a class and you mention a film. You're like, oh, and who's seen Jaws? And they'll be like, and you're talking Jaws. You're not talking about some obscure film. And half the class will raise their hand. And it's just like,
yeah,
you need to see these things. I mean, you know?
Well, that's how you, we saw everything. We talked about movies constantly. We saw them constantly.
But we were also into comic books as well. And that's like one of the things that I think that helped us in our sense of graphicness that, words and pictures are, that's what movies are. But, obviously, moving pictures. Mm-hmm. But, so we actually got into comic books before anything, We were drawing comic books as kids.
What were some of the comic book writers and artists that you were drawn to?
When we were super young, we liked Jack Kirby a lot. We liked his art a lot. Mm-hmm. And a lot of his like weird, obscure books too, The Inhumans and strange stuff. But then later, you know, we got into X-Men and Chris Claremont and
Marv Wolfman.
Yeah, we liked
Alan Moore, Swamp Thing.
Yeah, but
Bill Sienkiewicz was. That was the first
radical,
abstract-looking comic where you, whoa!
Did you get into Daniel Klaus at all?
Yeah, we loved him. Yeah, he's fantastic.
The 8-Ball series was just my favorite stuff.
Like a velvet glove.
Yes.
It was awesome. Yeah. So, yeah, there was always this desire to tell visual stories that our imaginations worked very visually, and it was kind of a dream to be a writer, but you often had to work a lot harder to describe the things, whereas pictures, 1,000 words. Maybe you've heard of that expression.
I've heard that one. Do you think that helped prepare you when you started directing then? I mean, because you were basically doing storyboards at a young age, right?
Sure, probably.
Yeah, definitely.
And I assume you storyboard everything still.
Yeah, we're using the same guy that we used when we were in the comic book industry.
Really?
This guy who drew this comic that we did, Ecto Kid.
Okay.
Steve Scrooge.
Ecto Kid is actually the Rosetta Stone of all of our work.
We discovered
Ecto
the truth
Kid.
If we went back to that.
It's really freaky. We read it. I read some issues. I was like, oh my God. It's like all of our ideas are actually in Ecto Kid. Matrix is in there.
Mm-hmm.
Cloud Atlas is in there. It's all in there.
That's pretty cool. And you grew up around Chicago, so and we were talking briefly about kind of the music scene and how that I can see, you know, the choice of the scores that you have in your films and the type of music that you put in, and even not all the films, but early on when it seemed like you were kind of finding your aesthetic, the Chicago industrial music scene looks like it had a little influence. Were you part of that? Did you listen to that stuff? Did you go to any of those?
Yeah, a lot of Matrix is written to Ministry and, you know,
really?
Rage
really?
Against the Machine, but a lot of Ministry.
That's very
Just
cool.
One Fix. It's good to write to.
Yes, Just One Fix. Yeah, you can write anything to that.
Yeah.
But music is emotional, mm-hmm. and we always liked the juxtaposition of that kind of anger. I mean, Rage Against the Machine was an amazing album, that first album when it came out, and we were like, we want to try to write things that have this kind of political context, and yet it has all of this emotion in it. It's like politics and philosophy and ideas don't have to be boring or uninteresting. I mean, that was one of our early, even in our comic books and things, we were always first primarily interested in ideas. Mm-hmm. And stories became a way of exploring or pushing out at an idea that we were kind of interested in.
Mm-hmm.
That's how Bound sort of came out, and we were thinking about gender stereotypes and the way that paradigms have a lot of those stereotypes built into them, and we were wondering what can you do with that sort of, if an audience has all of those paradigms built into their subconscious, can you sort of start messing with them and engage them in another way? And then that becomes kind of a way to interrogate those paradigms. Mm-hmm. And then you try to, you know, we usually try to push to some sort of politically interesting point of view at the same time. And we were looking around and, you know, at that period, we couldn't find a single film in a genre like Bound is, where two gay characters went off and lived happily ever after.
Right.
So we were wondering, can you then interrogate these old paradigms and at the same time then try a brand new one that's never been done? And then The Matrix sort of started in a similar way, where we were like talking about the problem with virtual reality, like
Neuromancer
and all of the Gibson books, and he can write, you know, in his prose, in his fancy prose, that it's just like reality, the table is just like reality. But then when you go see the movie and it's like some crazy Lawnmower Man cartoon,
yes,
the audience doesn't actually feel that there's reality there. Mm-hmm. So we're like, well, you just swap reality and you say reality is virtual. And we're like, hey, that's kind of interesting. Mm-hmm. And then that led us to a discussion of how you interrogate reality and what reality is and what, and you know, that led us into the entire philosophical spectrum of what the Matrix ended
up being. Your films are so smart. I mean, they're so well, very, really tight, well written, and very intelligent. Something like Bound, there had to have been people that were like, no, we're not going to finance that, or?
Well, Bound, I mean, all of the, each step that we took, you know, down our career, there was always these funny opportunities that were sort of luck-based where the industry was in some flux or something, and, mm-hmm. you know, we had our first script out there, and this thing called Assassins, and Dino De Laurentiis had optioned it and then turned around and sold it to Warner Brothers for, you know, like $5 million.
Right.
He got it first, he gave it $10,000 we got as our first option money. We're like, oh my God.
We're in Fab City.
We're going to be rich forever.
Coke and horse for everybody.
Yes, right.
And then we got and then one day he was like, we're trying to understand what the option thing meant. We're like, what does it mean? And they're like, well, they'll keep paying you $10,000 until they pay you the whole thing. And they're like, what? We will never have to work ever, ever. And then they sent us a check for like a couple $100,000.
Yeah,
and we're like,
$180,000.
Yeah.
We're going to buy an island.
Yeah, right. I made it.
Then Dino sold it to Warner for $5 million.
Yeah.
And he said,
and we were like,
what are you doing next?
Yeah, right.
And we're like,
you're very talented. I want to use you.
Yeah.
I want to teach you.
But by then, we had done some, it was already going down the pipe with Warner Brothers. And Donner was directing it, and we weren't sure about that choice. And we felt like, you know, we wanted to try and direct something, and we had this idea, and we sort of, you know, Dino, he was this 75-year-old Italian guy, and we were sort of hemming and hawing around the idea of this, you know, basically a lesbian noir. And we, you know, he was saying, we're like, well, there's this one girl, she's out of prison, and then she meets this other girl, and then they sort of fall in love, and then they get the money, and they ride off into the sunset. And Dino's like, this first girl, she is a lesbian? And we're like, well, yeah. And this other girl, she also is a lesbian? Like, yeah, yeah. And he's like, we have a deal.
Right, yeah.
But it was funny because the lesbian movie that was in Dino's head
was not the movie that was
in our head.
Right.
Speaking of aesthetics, right? Like, so then aesthetically,
Penthouse Forum.
Sure, right, yeah.
We went and we shot the lesbian bar scene as our first date. You know, we're super nervous, but the whole bar is filled with very sort of famous San Francisco and L.A. lesbians. And we shoot the scene, and you know, oh God, Dino has to see the dailies first. Mm-hmm. So you're like, ugh. And then he sees them, and he calls, and he's like,
he got to see, he watched our dailies before we did, so it was always nervous making.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Yeah. And he calls us up, and he's like, you must reshoot the lesbian bar.
And I need to be there.
No. He was like, he's like, we're like, what, really, why, what's wrong? And he's like, this is not what a lesbian bar looks like. And we're like, what do you mean?
Really?
He's like, those are not lesbians. And we're like, actually, they are.
Not the ones, like, that I think of.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
It was an aesthetic.
Bah.
We're on a different aesthetic wavelengths.
But do you think that, going back to just Assassins, once again, I don't want to keep going through like the history kind of stuff, but Assassins, I know that somebody said, oh, you don't talk about Assassins. And it's like, whatever, we're all friends here. So, like, I know that they, well, maybe we won't be after this. But you're from Chicago, and we have an attitude, right? I mean, we Chicago, we're right. And
is that an attitude?
It's just we just know we're right.
It's the truth.
It's the truth, right? It's the truth. And I was in LA for a little bit too, and it's like a breath of fresh air out there when you have that kind. You bring that to the table. You're just like, no, this is the way I want it to be, and this is the way I see it. And well, no, you can't do that. It's like, well, screw you. I can do that. And I know that there was controversy about you wanted to get your Assassins. The film that came out was not really the script that you, at least most of it, right? So you were pissed.
We didn't really, we were fine. They bought it and they went off and we went off and made Bound. And it was kind of funny because we were making Bound at the same time. And I remember there was this big day where Joel was so excited and he was like, oh my God, it's amazing, it's amazing. Wait till you see it, wait till you see it. And then he sent the movie over and we were just sitting and watching it in this editorial room and we're just like, and they had taken out all of the things that we had written the screenplay about. We were kind of interested in the idea of kind of pocket moral universes. Mm-hmm. Like in our moral world, we have all these ideas of what's right, what's wrong, blah, blah, blah. And we're like, well, can you enter one of those moral universes and then get involved in it and then escape from it? Mm-hmm. That's kind of what we were interested in. Can you be somebody who imagines murder in the same way you would imagine chess, mm-hmm. and then can you then go back to the other moral world? That's what was interesting to us. And he cut all that out.
Right.
That part he wasn't interested in, which is fine. You know, that's the business part of it.
We were mad about it. We were mad that the Writers Guild didn't protect us, that we could take our name off of it.
Right,
like if you, it was this outrageous thing where if you made a certain amount of money on your script,
which was like a minimum.
Yeah, it was the wage minimum.
Right.
That you're not actually allowed to take your name off your script.
But maybe I'm totally reading into it, but I think just the mere fact that it's like, hey, I want my name off this, shows that you have. I mean, you got a spine and you got an attitude and you have, this is not what I wanted. And to me, it seems like that goes a long way with people banking on you. Like, you know what, we're gonna give them a shot. I mean, because really, I mean, you were screenwriters and then you're jumping into directing a larger film and then you jump in to do The Matrix, which is even a bigger, more complicated in a lot of ways film. And I feel like there's, people don't wanna bank on somebody that's going to be wishy-washy. They want to bank on someone that has the attitude.
There's no real formula. I mean, you'll see them bank on wishy-washy people all the time.
LA is its own moral pocket.
Yeah. Moral.
Yeah.
I mean, you're like, how can that guy, he keeps getting fired? They reshoot it. Why does he keep getting hired? You know, who knows? I think there's just how you work as an artist.
Mm-hmm.
And wishy-washy people work one way and we work this other way where we have an idea of what it is, and if we're not able to do that, then we don't really know how to do it.
Right.
So we made Bound and it was under a lot of tension with Dino at first, and then he seemed to say like, well, they know what they want, but he kind of like then shunned us a bit and we were like the bad child while
Jonathan
Mostow.
No, it was John Dahl.
John Dahl, right.
He was made.
And Mostow.
Red Rock
and
West.
Mostow, yeah.
Red Rock
yeah.
West and stuff like
they
that.
They were in the same building at the same time as us making their pictures.
And he loved them, and they got along, and they were like the good children, and we were like the misbehaving, stubborn, obstinate, horrible middle children.
Yeah, at some point we decided to say to Dino, look, you know, if we're going to fail, we want to fail our way,
right,
and not your way, because, you know, we don't know how to do it your way.
And there's never some moment where you're, okay, they're bankable, you know.
Right.
Every single time, it's always, well, if you make Bound again, then we'll bank on you. But we didn't want to make Bound again. We wanted to make The Matrix. So then we sat around for 3.5 years drawing The Matrix.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, you know, we wanted to make this super experimental aesthetic film. And Warner Bros. Was like, whoa, whoa, whoa. And they were all sort of uptight about that for a while. And then we went from that to Cloud Atlas. Mm-hmm. We did Vendetta. And everyone's like, you can't do something that political. It's too dangerous right now. And then, you know, we did Cloud Atlas, which everyone was like, this is impossible. You cannot make this movie. You know, you never get to this moment where we've never had it in our careers where it's just like, everyone's like, well, let me sign the check.
Yeah. Can I ask, and maybe you've answered this before in other arenas, but like, how do you, I work with a writing partner. Actually, I worked with a cousin of mine for a long time. And how do you two work together? I mean, how do you, who comes up, do you both kind of talk about ideas? Do you share books? Do you share film ideas? I mean, how does that dynamic actually work? Do what we want to know? I'm just curious, because it's, I mean, you're super close, obviously, and you've been working together since you started in this industry.
Well, we grew up, we played together, we loved hanging out, we loved playing, we loved going to movies together. We still, you know, even when we go to Hollywood, we always have this, because we don't usually go with our wives, and we have this great, where we just watch the worst movie on whatever the hotel cable is and get, like, smashed. Make fun of the movie constantly. Pacific Rim was the last.
Yeah.
It's quite fun. But, you know, it's, and the dynamic of working is, you know, we've built a really great relationship. We're very kind to each other. We're very supportive.
Do you have any instances where you just disagreed? I mean, on certain things in a process?
You know, there's, you always have these moments when somebody objects to something, but if somebody's objecting to something, it means that there's something wrong in the story, and it like presents an opportunity to try and find a better way, because always there is a better way.
It was really interesting when we introduced, this mic seems very loud to me, that when we introduced Tom into the mix, and it was kind of a new dynamic, but it allowed another perspective to sort of push the idea even broader. And we took it as like another opportunity. So now, instead of just the two of us agreeing on some, or finding a path that we both felt, now we had to find a path for all three of us. And it was like, it was amazing.
That's really cool.
You find, you know, new sort of vision, new vistas that you didn't know were there until this other set of eyes came along.
Well, getting back to aesthetics, I'm going to go to talk a little bit about, I mean, like, as I was saying before, how you wanted to do different things. Like, you seemed you wanted to kind of challenge the, you know, the way people think of movies. And the Matrix, aesthetically, there's been so many copycats from that point on of that type of sci-fi action kind of film. What I found fascinating, and I went and rewatched the film, and it doesn't age at all. It's you know, it's like one of those great songs. You're talking about Rage Against the Machine, that first album sounds as good today as it did when it first came out. And the Matrix has this aesthetic. It's kind of setting off this new aesthetic where, you know, we have when we watch a film, the film language tells us the camera is here and there's a cut and we're moving through time, and when there's something important to see, we'll cut to a close-up. And you kind of change those rules, or whatever you want to call them, principles, where the camera actually wasn't really tied to anything, especially in some of the action sequences, which hasn't really been seen before.
Well, this is good. Now we're getting to a more interesting subject. I think there's a very interesting, I think, aesthetic genealogy to the Matrix. And if you really want to understand any art medium, you have to start understanding aesthetics. It's like studying life and having to, you need to understand how DNA works. Aesthetics are like the DNA of art. And it's really the way that you begin to understand intent, artistic intent, is really a reflection of, it's the way that artists reveal themselves and their choices aesthetically. So Matrix was interesting because in some ways it's, we're kind of like fancy Chicago fusion cooks, right? So we're taking a lot of things that are out there and we're sort of mixing them in a way that hasn't been mixed. For me, I always felt that whenever you have an aesthetic shift in what the dominant cultural aesthetic is, that movie or that piece of art is always attacked. People always hate it. Mm-hmm. Like Picasso, when he revealed Guernica, was actually chased to the train station by an angry mob. I mean, aesthetics really, when you assault a dominant aesthetic, usually people get, they feel almost violent.
Right.
And for me, the origin of the aesthetic of something like The Matrix really starts with Blade Runner, which was a very urban, gritty, high contrast, you know, very moody light, very, and that movie, when it came out at the time, I don't know, it's probably way before, but there was another movie that came out the same year, which was called E.T.
Right.
And E.T. was done in sort of this very dominant aesthetic of the day. It was very soft, glowy light. It was, the contrast was very low. It was very filtered light.
The storyline was clear.
The storyline is very clear. There's an innocence to the style. And really, Scott was more interested in this kind of aesthetic that came out of really noir, or kind of, it went through Coppola and the Godfather series, but this idea of this very aggressive, dark aesthetic. And he took it and he applied it to science fiction. And everyone hated Blade Runner when it came out. It was a universally despised movie, except for us. We were the only two people who went to see the movie in Chicago, I think. We went, I think I saw it three times, and then it was like closed within like...
Well, that voiceover, though, was pretty hard to get past.
Didn't matter. The movie was so visually stunning.
Yeah,
and I would just argue with my friends who just worshipped E.T. and everyone was like, E.T., E.T., phone home, phone home. And I was like, oh my God, it's so...
Elliot lives in my building, by the way.
Does he?
He does. He lives in Old Town. He's shooting, I think it's Mind Games. Henry Thomas, right?
Yeah,
that's
Henry
his name.
Thomas, yeah.
Lives in my building. I'll tell him you said hi.
Give him your best. And anyway, so... In a way, Ridley Scott paved the way. He actually paid the price for that very aggressive aesthetic. But the other part of aesthetics is that if you do forge this new ground, very often you're remembered. And Blade Runner continues to be an important seminal picture because of its aesthetic dynamic. And yeah, aesthetics continue to, like, it's weird that people don't talk about aesthetics in cinema. I mean, you don't study them. Did you ever hear the word in a class? I'm curious.
We try to, right? We try to, right?
Nobody writes about them. No critic ever mentions the word. I mean, no critic will ever mention the word symbol or the meaning of a symbol.
Right, for sure.
No one will try to identify a symbol. Mm-hmm. And yet, what are movies, they're actually visual images that are symbols, usually of something else. And they will never talk about aesthetics. It's like, why? I don't understand it. It's the weirdest silent thing. Like, I saw my wife who makes the most amazing, we have a movie club and she makes the most amazing double feature. She kind of put together Snow White and the Huntsman. Did anyone see that? Moonrise, Moonrise Kingdom. Did you see that? What's astonishing for anyone who saw the two movies, we had a very elaborate presentation. We were going to show the trailers and then.
I'm going to show some stuff. I didn't tell you. Oh. Now I'm telling you now. It'll be fine. Don't worry. It'll be good. Don't worry. It's fine. Speed Racer stuff.
Okay.
Yeah, it'll be good.
But we watched these two movies and I realized that they are unbelievably the exact same movie. I mean, they are the same movie. Everything is the same. The plot is the same. The characters are the same. The themes, their tone is different, and the aesthetics are different. And that's it. And no one ever compared them. which is amazing. They came out in the same month, and nobody said, hey, you know what? These are the same movie. But it's like a girl runs away from a strange dynamic in which there's a sexual tension with the blonde evil woman. They both end up meeting this Boy Scout huntsman who's an outdoors guy. They're afraid of the woods, but then they become attracted to each other and have a slightly strange sexual encounter that then brings them into an Eden, all the while they're being pursued by a troop of small men. Dwarves who hate them at first and try to get them and hunt them wildly, but then sit around the campfires, both, and talk about farting and eating and stuff, both, unbelievably, and then have a change of heart and end up helping them and rescuing them and saving them, while the evil blonde queen sends another emissary to hunt them down, and eventually the hero Boy Scout guy, huntsman, saves her and they go off.
Roll a clip.
I didn't have that one.
And what's even interesting is that both movies defy logic in the service of their aesthetic. So in The Huntsman, there's this amazing scene where they're charging on the beach and the cannonballs are falling and, you know, it's all just about this, like, aesthetic idea of like wanting to see slow motion horses and the surf, and then you think like, okay, who would build a castle on a beach? The flood would come in every day. Everything.
The castle sunk again. Let's build another one. Damn it.
It has no logic, but aesthetically it's beautiful, so they do it anyway. And then in the other movie, there's this like crazy goofy shot where you're tracking along at the fort, and there's all these like sight gags happening in the back, and they're not logical or believable or realistic, but it's just Wes Anderson thinks it's funny and he wants to put this little sequence in there. And so both movies not only have the same plots, the same characters, they have the same intention, and still no one perceived. That's how powerful aesthetics are. You can't even see through the aesthetic to see that the story is the same.
It's funny. You're talking about. I was thinking that your scripts are so smart. You know, they're so well written and super smart. There's so many ideas in your script, and applying this, what you're talking about, this aesthetic to some of these smart things, I think is the thing that I think is so amazing. Like, just the idea of bullet time, you know, that idea, let's do this, but it's tied so much into the script and the story, so I used to talk about the movie, remember the movie Jacob's Ladder? Remember that? And I read that script when I was in school, and I just thought it was just an amazing script.
Bruce Joel Rubin,
right? Mm-hmm. And I saw the movie, and I was really disappointed.
Also wrote Ghost, I believe.
He did write Ghost, yeah, he did write Ghost. And and I was thinking, God, I wish a different director took that film and applied a different aesthetic to it. Because it would be it would be a completely different film. And just the idea of, we talked the other day, I just mentioned David Lynch. And David Lynch, if he directed Jacob's Ladder, it would be a completely different film. Because aesthetics are so important to Lynch and symbols and all these other kind of things. When you did The Matrix, was there any kind of conscious, like, we're doing things different, people aren't doing this? And was it scary? You know, because when you're exploring like new ways of expressing yourself, aesthetically especially, you can fail. I mean, you can like miss the mark. And was there any kind of,
it was just like all of these things we're interested in. So we're interested in interrogating reality. And then we were interested in martial arts movies. And we had never seen a Western film have like a big famous star do the kinds of things that Jet Li was doing in Hong Kong movies. And we're like, wow, if you could get an actual Hollywood star to do something like this, it would be amazing.
Because to some extent, that was our biggest visual effect, was that, you know, you had never seen these guys do this before.
Right.
And then suddenly, you know, he downloads Kung Fu into his brain and you can do it. And it's not two stunt guys doing it or some head replacement thing.
Right. I mean, when we grow up, you just expected the cut to the stuntman. Right. It was like that's what how you watched action. You saw the close-up of the hero, and then you saw the wide shot or the medium shot of the stunt guy. That's how it worked.
I mean, it's also like, I think we ended up watching a lot of Westerns when we were kids, and so you would see the actor climbing up onto the horse and like taking off, and that was always something that was incredibly impressive to us. So I think like that was the early seed of that idea, maybe. Mm-hmm.
And then the you know, we were trying to find a way to visually express an idea of the delimitation of reality. So we were talking about how every audience member has a relationship to a camera move being related to time and space. So you have to move a camera through space, and it takes a certain amount of time. You know, we talked about, could you put a camera on a rocket? I mean, we were trying to, how do you begin to express the kind of idea that we were looking for of being able to push at the boundaries of reality? So in the script, we were able to, like William Gibson, use lots of flowery language to describe this idea. But then people would say, well, how are you going to do that? Right. And we were like, we're working on it.
We're working on it.
And then we met John Gaeta, and he came up with a very brilliant possibility.
Yeah.
We didn't know if it was true, and then we...
Yeah, there's these other things, too, that I go back to with The Matrix, that when you're talking about how the audience experiences an aesthetic and this and that, goes back to your writing again, where there's a moment in the film when it's the glitch in The Matrix, which always... I loved it when I saw it in the theater, and I loved it when I saw it this week in, you know, Deja Vu is a glitch in The Matrix. And it's a moment where the audience, you actually, it's almost like you're giving them this great little philosophical mind, you know, thought experiment, you know, and everybody that watches that or sees that moment, they go, oh, am I actually dreaming this life? I mean, that's kind of, I mean, maybe it's just me, but it's that moment where you actually do put the audience, you personalize it for them, in that this reality that we're all seeing, we're watching this movie, and like we were talking the other day, the movie is a matrix itself, but you're putting the audience in that, in their personal lives too. It's like, oh yeah, I've had deja vu, holy shit, what if this is a big computer program? And I had a friend in high school who used to always say he was a nut. He's not a nut. He's a wonderful, funny guy. He's actually, Scott Adsett, he's on 30 Rock, and he's done some other things. But he would always say he's convinced that he's the only human in the world and everybody's a robot. And I'd be like, well, you're nuts. And he's like, well, I can't prove otherwise. Like, I can't prove it unless I rip someone's head off and I see blood spurting off. And so how do I know? So that moment in The Matrix I just thought was great when you kind of bring the audience into it. Going back to, I want to get more on aesthetics, and I want to get to Speed Racer, because Speed Racer is a very, I grew up in Chicago, you grew up in Chicago, we were around the same age group, generation. It was, and I don't think you students could ever understand what this cartoon meant to people of our generation. It was the most violent, crazy cartoon that was on like Happy Family Hour time on TV, and every kid knew that it was, we're gonna watch some death today, and you know, some.
Well, the introduction has like five people die.
Yeah, right. Yeah, right.
I was like, wow.
Right. And so, when I saw you were doing that, I was like, oh, that's freaking awesome, man, because that's perfect. And the film, you're talking about challenging audiences and having them react. You know, oh, this is, you know, because the aesthetic in that film, to me, is even more groundbreaking than stuff in The Matrix. I mean, it really, there's some amazing stuff. I actually have, is it cool if I show a couple tiny things from Speed Racer? I'm gonna, if he's, not.
He's doing it anyway.
I'm doing it anyway. But just like the opening of the film, like I tell my students, the most important, it's not the most, but one of the most important things you can do in a film is introduce it. The opening images are going to tell an audience what they're going to watch.
But is this the edited version, or is it the
whole? No, it's just the titles, you know, Village Roadshow, and just how the intro to that film itself, I remember seeing in the theater, tells you this is not, it's not a traditional, in my head, you know, normal film, or whatever you want to call it. It's not an animated film. It's not, because Speed Racer could have been so, you know, snarky and, you know, ha ha ha, look how ridiculous Speed Racer was. But it wasn't. The film wasn't. You were taking it very seriously, and you obviously you loved it. You loved that stuff. And just the introduction was this trippy, psychedelic thing. And I want to show the opening and maybe talk a little bit about that. And then get into...
Lay it on us.
Then getting into the idea of cutting, like the idea of a cut, and how within that film...
We got lots of things.
You don't, yeah, you don't do the traditional way of doing things. So if we can roll, press button. We can press button, we can just watch the, and I'm sorry, I apologize how low res and, but these are the opening titles. When you watch the original show, the original cartoon, it's you actually have the, you know, the check, red and check, or whatever you want to call it. I don't know if it's the Finnish flag or whatever it is. You have that, so you're paying like, oh yes, this is Speed Racer. But the intro to it is unlike anything I've seen. So what was the?
That was the cue for everyone to drop their.
Yeah, right. Yeah, let's take your pills and right. That's what I figured. Is that the 2001
That's
influence?
Right, exactly.
I mean, you talked about how that was a huge. Are we like sound got problems here?
Check. Mic check.
Mic check. Check. Peas and carrots. Great. Are we coming off okay, everybody?
Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, good. We'll just.
Hello?
But you talked about 2001 and how that was like.
Well, at first we were going through the trilogy, right? And the trilogy was, it was also somewhat, like making three movies has its own challenges for people who are kind of visually and aesthetically minded. We were very afraid of what we saw in a lot of sequels, which was this sort of commodifying process, or really a kind of commodifying ossification of an original idea. So from the very beginning, the philosophical arc of the trilogy was conceived. That was what we wanted to do that all in one movie, but we couldn't quite fit it. And it was the idea of this philosophical investigation. What is reality? How do I know? What do I know? And then you come to a revelation or a moment of enlightenment, and then you basically assault that moment of enlightenment and you deconstruct it. So we wanted to go through the sort of postmodern deconstruction of all those ideas. And then we wanted to say, okay, now where do we go after we deconstruct everything that we thought we believed or thought we knew? And that was going to be the revolutions. And at the same time, we were like kind of trying to change the way, you know, we were explaining that we always thought it was funny that no one actually noticed that the movies are matrices. We thought that would be like the instantaneous sort of insight somebody would have, like, oh, well, you know what, you're making this matrix, but movies are matrixes. Because you go into a movie and they tell you how to feel, they tell you what to think, they basically sort of cocoon you and separate you, and you turn your thinking apparatus off and you sit there and you're like, Harry Potter, oh. And
I mean, you could feel it in the backlash when the second and third ones came out. Like, everyone wanted to be in their cocoon. They wanted, what? The Matrix!
Right.
The Matrix!
And so
what
we
about
were.
The Matrix!
We had this whole interesting kind of concept. Intellectually, we were wondering, could you link an audience's path to Neo's path? Mm-hmm. So can you start off and have this moment of like, oh, enlightenment, and the audience gets all excited, oh, wow, I can fly. And then then assault all of that and tear it apart and break it all up and break it all apart and break it down. Like, I love, people ask about, oh, the pills, I love the pills, the red pill, the blue pill, it's my yeah. life, I'm so there. And I say, yeah, that's great. And this is one of the things that, this is one of the tools that we use to sort of kind of help us get through life, this idea that choice, you know, we have these choices and we make these choices. Well, the whole arc of the path is that the first one shows this sort of choice world of red and blue pill, but then the second one gets to the same exact paradigm. So there's two doors. The doors are exactly the same as the red pill, blue pill. But the whole point is that by the time Neo is at the door, you want the audience to be conjoined with Neo so that you understand that there is no choice, that choice is in itself an illusion. Mm-hmm. And that's what we were trying to do with the visual metaphor, again, a symbol. Mm-hmm. You know, we're trying to like say things visually through the whole trilogy that are often overlooked or not seen. But there's a series of shots with the architect where you're moving from Neo talking to all the monitors and he says all these different things, but then you move towards one monitor and that becomes reality again. So here's a visual metaphor that we're trying to say, this huge field of choices is like going to the grocery store and you see all these labels of all these different products, but they're all made by the same exact company. Mm-hmm. And this was an idea that we had, that there is something in our makeup that really has almost made up our mind before we get there. And so Neo doesn't really have a choice. He's going to go save Trinity, which was then we were juxtaposing the idea of what is a messiah. So you're trying to say like, okay, you're interrogating the reality of a messiah or the paradigm of a messiah. And we're like, well, all these other messiahs in history, Jesus, Buddha, whatever, they love everyone in this sort of equanimical way where Neo's showing all these people, and we love that Keanu's reaction is so great. He was like, what am I supposed to be doing here? And we're like, exactly that. You are so not connected to all those people.
And who the fuck are these people? And then Trinity comes up and he's like, Trinity! Because he loves one person.
Right.
So Jesus can love everyone, right? He can kind of like love all of you people. But me as a person, I can't.
Right.
I can't access that. And so we were kind of wondering, well, is maybe a messiah more interesting, or is it a new paradigm if a messiah loved the way we love? Mm-hmm. Like, where does that get us? Right. And so that kind of led us then to the third movie, which has a whole other history to it. But while we were going through it, we just kept saying, like, God, I'm just so sick of the way all these movies look the same. They're just like the same. And at this point, all the other people are like imitating us. We were like trapped in this like house of mirrors where you go to movies and you're like, oh my God, that's our shot.
Right.
But we were also shooting for 270 days. So yeah, we were in our own, you know, straitjacket.
Right.
And you know, you just like are so, you go to a museum, like, I don't know, do you guys go to the Art Institute, one of the most amazing places in the entire city? But you walk in there and look at the unbelievable range that you can represent a human face. I mean, the aesthetic juxtaposition in the Art Institute of just the human face is so incredible. Sometimes you can't even see that it's a face. But then the artist will say, yes, I'm painting my wife here. And we just feel like right now cinema is kind of like the 12th century painters in the Dark Ages, where they had to work under the Catholic Church and basically go in every single representation of Mary looks identical for like 500 years.
Right.
And that's kind of what movie aesthetically kind of has, this claustrophobic absolute straitjacket where it's like movies must look a certain way or audiences will not go see them.
Right.
It's like you guys are like the Catholic Church. If a movie looks weird, you guys go, oh God, that's weird.
Yeah,
it's not even that, it's also plot. I mean, there are those guys who are those like economist guys who are now coming in and getting involved in the movie business, and they're saying,
at this point in the movie, there has to be this kind of conflict. And at this point of the movie, there's the big gloom.
Yeah.
And the hero has to arise out of this. And right. they've, like, taken this template and they've laid it on, like, all these...
It's like Moneyball for film.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And so you go to this place where you start, like, thinking about what's possible. And you know, I love modern art and, you know, I love modern literature. And I love the way that postmodern literature, postmodern authors have been able to really assault the form of literature in all sorts of really interesting, cool ways, including interjecting pictures. You know, now it's like legitimate. And but they take something like as simple as a sentence, right? So in cinema, a sentence is a cut. It's from one beginning of one cut to the end of another cut. And we were so sick of sentences. You know, we're like, and you read Melville or you read Joyce or you read even Rick Moody, where he has like this one sentence that goes on for like 80 pages. And this is how my brain works. Like, my brain doesn't have sentences. I'm like, I'm talking now, I can probably talk endlessly, and I'm thinking of this script that I'm working on at the same time, and I'm thinking about something we were looking at a trailer for Jupiter, and that's going on kind of, and there's no sorting, it's just all happening, and I can kind of access them at different moments.
Can I show this? I'm just because you're.
Yeah.
Talking
so this
exactly
is what I was trying to set up. Yeah. Is that we were trying to get to a way to express that.
Yeah,
visually.
Yeah, and can I roll that, guys? Press button. I mean.
Holy cannoli, Speed.
You know who you're racing?
Yeah.
Nobody's gonna stop him.
Quiet, Speed. Still a lot of race to go.
No way. It's over. My brother's the best racer in the world. Everyone else is running for second.
Yeah! I told you to take him out!
You're trying, sir. We're trying, but he's just too fast.
Like this since that remarkable night 8 years ago.
There's no doubt in my mind. He's gunning for the record.
He is not alone out there. He is chasing someone. He is chasing the ghost of Rex Racing.
Jeepers, he could do it, Pops. He could really do it. What if he does it? What if he does it, Pops?
So context-wise, is that three races in one unbroken kind of sequence? Like past, and it's his brother racing, it's yeah. him racing, and is there a...
Well, it starts with them...
It starts with them on the track
on
together.
The track
okay, right,
together.
Yeah. So it's this jumping through time in this really seamless way. It's kind of exactly what you were talking about.
Yeah, so... We were trying to express this idea of context, of stream of conscious context. So there's like history to everything that's happening now, and then there's awareness and different perspectives. So there's the family's perspective on the history, and there's his perspective, and we were trying to find a way to do something like that, and yet we became kind of interested in this dynamic where Picasso began thinking like, well, why do I have to just see what I'm looking at when I can imagine seeing it from over here at the same time? Why do I have to just limit myself to this single perspective? Why can't I see it simultaneously from this other perspective? So we were wondering, is there a way to do that kind of thing in a movie where you're constantly shifting perspectives and you're blending them and blurring them? And we didn't, and we thought that it was kind of funny that Picasso ended up flattening things out and then sort of merging them together. And cell animation kind of has this similar thing where it flattens and layers. And we thought it's kind of cubist, but it's kind of also cell animation. So we thought maybe there was something there, and then we began montaging stuff and sort of playing with it in the Avid. And it's a very modern movie. I mean, it's a digital movie. It could not be made on a flatbed. You couldn't make this editorial sequence without computer.
The other awesome thing about it was it allowed us to tell the story way, way faster than you could normally tell the story with regular cutting.
I was going to say that the other cool thing is that you don't treat your audiences like they're morons. I mean, you treat them like you're expecting them to be able to absorb. There's a lot of information going on in there, a lot. But it still has this heart of this guy who's basically has this his dead brother. I mean, he's chasing his dead brother. And it comes back to this real human kind of thing. And you're shooting all this information at the audience and saying, follow it, because you can. And I think that if more filmmakers did that, I think it would, like, you'd see, there'd be, what I want to say is, like, there'd be more of a, because when the film came out, I mean, critically, they were like, what is this, right?
Yeah. They were worse than that.
That was a nice way of putting it, right? Yeah, right. But now, I mean, I kid you not, you
chased us out of town.
Yeah, right. They were like Paso. There was a whole town where pitchforks.
It was cheap.
But I think that if more filmmakers took that on, maybe 3D might be a way where, you know, because we were talking about that new aesthetic of 3D that's kind of coming into more and more film. If more filmmakers kind of did this kind of stuff, it would become more of an art form and be more accepted, and people, you know, might. But you go on the internet with Speed Racer. Like if you Google Speed Racer, you're going to see blogs about how it was one of the best films in the past, you know, 10, 15 years.
It is,
right. I know. But,
and it is an art form. You know, that's how we got into it. That's what we're interested in. It is an art form, and why it's a special art form, we think, is because it's a social art form. Most art forms classically, as we understand them, are about soul visionary people who sit and, you know, write their novel or paint or sculpt off in their ivory tower. But filmmaking is this amazing art form because it can't be really made alone. You have to have a group of artists working with you. That's what makes movies so interesting, I find. And to understand them, really, you have to understand where the aesthetic comes from, all of these people, all of these conjoined artists, and if you start changing them, it would be a completely different work of art.
Do you think that your aesthetic is changing as you move forward and do more films? Cloud Atlas, I would say aesthetically is different than Speed Racer, and I would assume Jupiter Ascending is going to be different than Cloud Atlas. I mean, is there a conscious kind of, well, let's try this, let's do this different, or maybe is it just the material itself? Because Cloud Atlas is a complicated novel. Is it the material that kind of helps dictate a little bit more of the aesthetic, or is it really just this is the way we're going to present this?
Well, we don't like to do the same thing over and over and over. And, we've always tried to diverge from where we've been. I mean, Cloud Atlas was great because we got to work with Tom, and that was like the best part of it, in our opinion, I guess. Bringing the third wheel in.
Yeah, he's a super talented.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Lola Run, when that thing came out.
Long lost brother.
Yeah.
Same time as the Matrix.
Yeah, it's great stuff. I think we're gonna open up to questions because I'm talking so much and we're blabbing a lot. But before we get to that, where are you in Jupiter Ascending? We were talking about you're in the editing process.
Yep, we're about 8 weeks into our director's cut, and we're wrapping it up. So we'll get into sound and, you know, processing the visual effects.
And was it all shot in Chicago?
No, mostly in London. We shot 60 days in London and 30 to 40 here.
But you're doing all the post here?
Yeah, well, the visual effects companies are all over the place. Mm-hmm. There's a little work being done here. Method Studios has opened an office here.
Our studio's here, though.
Right. So you're home to stay, I assume?
Yeah, we're trying to work here as much as we can now. It's, Matrix took us away for, you miss all this part of your life when you work, especially when you work out of town. You know, people are born, they die, they grow up.
It's
shocking. It's a shock to the system.
Basketball players blow their knees out.
That's right.
Come back. That's right. It's so rusty.
Well, Jordan won the championship while we were shooting the dojo scene.
Really?
Yeah, the 300 frames per second shot of Fishburne in the air. Yeah.
Well, first we refused to direct.
That's right. Because of the time difference, we got to watch the games on our monitor during the day. Live. They pumped it into our monitor. It was fantastic.
Oh, that's great. That's great.
We basically made them lug this satellite dish over wherever we went in Sydney, and then they would set up, and we were like, we didn't care about the camera monitor. We were always like, where's the satellite monitor? Yeah. And then they hooked it up, and it was a hilarious moment because Fishburne in the dojo, in order to shoot, because that was shot on film, so you had to have all this light. It was
300 like, frames per second, the amount of light that you're pounding that set caught on fire all
constantly.
The time. And the camera light just smoked too. The mag just smoking.
And that was in the old days where you would go 300 frames, and it has this kind of energy where the camera just starts whipping through it. And that moment was, we were loading up to do the Flying Eagle. Fishburne's standing there, he's sweating, they're patting him down constantly with the powder. And James, our AD, is like, you guys ready, ready, ready? And we're like, we're staring at the game, and we're like...
It's like, Jordan, he's...
Carl
they're,
Malone.
They're talking about Carl Malone and his hands of stone. And right. Nobody steals the ball from Carl Malone.
It was like a movie, where we're like...
And we're like, they've got to call a time. And Jordan steals the ball out of his hands. And just as James is saying, you know, everybody, roll cameras. And we're like, oh, they're going to call a timeout.
They're going to call a timeout. They're going to call a timeout.
And Jordan like just takes the ball down. And we're like, oh, my God, they're not going to call a timeout.
And they're like, what do you do? And then, like, just as they're about to the guys are on the ladders ready to, like, jump and lift them up in the
cameras
air.
Cameras are going, whizz.
We're not even looking. We're staring at the monitor.
they're doing the countdown in Cantonese. So it's, yippee, ya, ye, sum. And...
Jordan shoots right then, almost right. It was like perfect, like almost unbelievable, and then like we scream.
And Fishburne is like, yeah, it was awesome.
No, it's everyone stops, and they're like, what? And we're like, go ahead. And then he did the eagle, and just as a sort of homage to Jordan, we, even though that wasn't the best take, we put that take in the movie so that we would always remember.
That's awesome.
That's for Jordan. Well,
and hopefully we'll get back there again with that team. So we have some students that want to ask some questions. So let's open it up to the, I guess this might be one of them. But where are we? Don't all ask it at once. So do you think Tom Thibodeau will win Coach of the Year?
I was just wondering. Are we good? Okay, sorry.
Yeah.
In Side by Side, Lana, you were saying that performance happens in the editing room. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more just about editing over your career, just kind of your approach to it, and how you guys do it.
Yeah, it's amazing how much you can vary a performance in editorial. It's really, I mean, not only is editorial the final rewrite, because you're really also writing the final draft of the script, but you're also a really good actor. We love actors. We think actors are amazing. We love working with them. And the really great ones, people like Hugo or Roger or...
Tom Hanks is the most unbelievable range of anybody that we've ever worked with.
But they give you when you give them notes, what you're doing, like if you're directing, never ask for a take the same way. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely worthless in an editorial process. You've got it, get something else, get another version, try, you know, say, you can louder, faster, colder, hotter, but we say weird things like you just heard that your mother died. just to get a different kind of energy out of the performance. And then what's amazing is how you can vary a performance with those subtle little shifts. Like a woman we just worked with on this movie, Jupiter Tuppence Middleton, not a very well-known person, but an amazing actress and just an incredible range. We could have made this character a total psychopath, a total sweet, gorgeous Bambi girl, or some, you know, we kind of have like a mixture. And it's really the process of directing is about trying to find that variation, which will give depth to the character, and then shaping it in the editorial process.
Yeah, it's an important part of the collaboration. That, you know, the idea of one director, one vision is this absolute rubbish.
It's rubbish.
It's like these actors, you can't imagine the variety of ways that the dialogue is done by somebody like Tom Hanks. You when you're writing it, you can't imagine all the variety that he's going to bring you in his performance. Mm-hmm. So you have to
even
be
David
open-minded.
Mitchell,
yeah,
you know, brilliant
right.
author,
that's
he
right.
came to the read through, and he was like, "Oh my God, I had that line in my head, and I thought it was so perfect." And then
Jim Broadbent
yeah. just like whipped out six different versions of the line, just like bam, 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 bam. And David was like, every single one of them was so much better than the one that was yeah. in my head.
Cool, thanks.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
So V for Vendetta is one of my favorite films. And so I wanted to ask why you chose not to direct it and if you have any regrets about not directing it.
No regrets. We love James.
Yeah, he's one of our best friends. He's wonderful. And he did a bang-up job. We were just coming out of, you know, the Matrix, the Reloaded and Revolutions, and, you know, we were beat up and we thought it would be, you know, a way to just keep our, you know, toe in the water. And, you know, James, you know, having worked with James as an AD, we could tell that he was, you know, going to be a really great filmmaker.
But that's a way that Hollywood is very classist. Mm-hmm. It's like once you are a certain job, it's very hard to break out of that job. Mm-hmm. And there aren't a lot of ADs that transition to directors. And we always thought he was an amazing, had amazing eye and was could have been a great filmmaker if he hadn't become an AD in a way. Yeah. And we said, you know, look, we'd love to help you get your first gig. And he read the script and he loved it. And that was kind of our big contribution. We did, there were things about the graphic novel that we didn't connect to, and we wanted to open up the ideas of it, and we shot some of the action, but beyond that, James
did a great job. We would have screwed it up, probably.
You probably like it because James did it.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hi.
Hi.
Good evening, Lana.
I like your sunglasses.
I'm Heather. I have a really deep, aesthetic, metaphysical question. Mm. I'm a proud graduate of the Matrix Forum fan site, and that was definitely one of the biggest classes there. And looking at the film overall, I mean, it has such a strong metaphysical context. What do you think, as far as a reflection in society? Because you mentioned that choice is ultimately an illusion, which was a big theme there as well. But in the film, it doesn't really present it that way. Almost everything is guided by a choice. And is that just our self-awareness? Or, I mean, there's just so many things that, the big thing that stands out for me has to do with identity and choice of pain and violence that people seem to be, it's almost a choice that people choose pain and suffering over other choices in their lives. It just seems a very strong theme from S&M to choosing to shoot people with a gun. I mean, everything from actually showing the ascension. I'm a big metaphysics fan, so. I just wanted to know what you thought about the audience's understanding of that, specifically since later on you moved it more towards Christianity and other religions people are more affiliated with and familiar
with.
No,
we didn't.
That was the reaction
from the
class.
You may be projecting that onto it.
Okay. And also, I'm surprised you said that you were such a Bulls fan since it's obviously Isaiah Thomas Neal Anderson.
Oh,
God.
Now the
take her away! Seize her!
Yeah, right.
Okay. Sorry, I just.
That's why you're wearing sunglasses.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I can't see. You're too bright. Sorry. Go, please.
Well, that's like 50 questions.
Yeah.
So would you like me to prioritize?
But at the end of the Matrix, it becomes less. What I was thinking is that the audience becomes Neo in the end, in that we were talking like it's up to them to figure out what it all means.
Yeah, so the third one has a gigantic symbol in it that no one ever really discusses. We put it to him, actually. We were like, well, okay, what's the gold light? Right, so that's kind of the key. If you basically work on what the trilogy is all about, you come to this symbol that is never discussed. No one ever talks about it. No one even mentions it. No one refers to it. And yet it's there, clearly. The third movie actually begins with the gold light as a part of the opening title montage, as if to say to you, look, this is an essential element. Mm-hmm. This is as important as the Matrix code is, right? So that light is what the third movie is trying to solve post deconstructing something like choice. So you can say like, okay, choice is important. Choice is a part of everyone's lives. But that paradigm of projecting choice is not different. It's a matrix, just like Catholicism or Christianity or symbols of metaphysics or really even philosophical constructs. This is why no one really mentions this, but everyone says, oh, simulacrum of Baudrillard, you're referencing Baudrillard. But the point of the reference is that the book is hollow. It is itself a matrix. It is itself a construction, a projection, a tool for understanding the world or having a framework of meaning. That's what these things are. They're frameworks of meaning. So what we were trying to do is, can you encourage audiences to interrogate their own framework for meaning, and then through that interrogation, extend it into the experience of watching a piece of art and then try to find meaning in that piece of art. In the same way that Neo has to go through this journey where he is told what to do, what to believe. First, everything is an illusion. It's revealed to be a construction. Then there's a new construction that's put on top of that construction. You're the one, blah, blah, religion, prophecy, oracle. So this matrix is like projected now onto the old matrix. And he's like, yeah, man, this is great. I can fly. I've got enlightenment. But then that enlightenment turns out to be false in the second one. It's like it's all a big lie. And so then he's like, whoa, what do I do now? It's all a big lie. And so that's what the third one is about.
So take that.
What are you going to do now?
Yeah, right.
Isaiah lover.
Yeah, right. How dare you.
Piston fan could never solve the third one. I'm kidding.
Who's the guy in the Pistons? Will Lambeer. Yeah, at least you didn't say
Bill
Lambeer.
Lambeer.
Right, Bill Lambeer, yeah, he was a tough one.
Hello.
Hi.
My name is Louie.
Louis.
I just want to say this conversation for the past hour has been amazing about talking about film as an aesthetic, because I thought I was one of very few that thought a film as an art form, because it's very hard for, you know, people who don't work in movies to look at it as an art form other than just entertainment. But my question right now really goes on to a different focus. It's about struggling as a filmmaker, because I know that when I graduate from film school, that I want to go to California to work, and I'll have to get a job to support myself and work small jobs to try to build as a big-time director. So my question for you all is, what were the struggles that you both experienced in the 90s, in the 80s and 90s, when you were rising as filmmakers that eventually built to Assassins and to Bound and to The Matrix?
There's no recipe, there's no formula. I mean, we were poor, starving carpenters for years and years. I mean, like I was saying, I mean, I wasn't kidding when I said we got a check for $10,000 and we thought we were the richest people in the world. I mean, that's not, that's like, I mean, that's what we would earn over 2 years.
But you kept doing it. You kept writing. Didn't you write like just a shitload of
yes,
stuff?
Yes, we wrote. We have boxes and boxes and boxes of stuff.
I think that's something that a lot of students need to really remind themselves, that you can have all the greatest ideas in the world, but they don't mean anything unless you get them out there and you write them. Even if they don't go anywhere, it's better to write a bad script than to not write any script.
I could tell a totally humiliating story.
Do it.
Wait a minute. What's the story?
Wait a minute.
Princess Bride.
Oh, yeah, that's a good story.
So I was like, I've got the greatest book to adapt. I didn't want to go to college. I was like, I want to be a writer. He was still in high school, and
I didn't want to go to high school. But they made me. Those bastards.
But so I went off to basically do what so many of my idols did: go off and find some grotto somewhere and write a great novel or a great screenplay. And I discovered I was reading William Goldman stuff at the time, and I found Princess Bride, and I was like, wow, this would be a really good movie. I wonder why this isn't a movie. And then I'm like, yeah, wait a minute. I don't have to think of anything. The structure is all here. I could just whip this out in a month or two. And it ended up taking like about 4 months. But I've, you know, wrote madly and had this like amazing, because I can only write in longhand, so I have all these pads of the Princess Bride screenplay. And it's like, went back home for Christmas, and I'm so excited and reading parts to my parents. Isn't this amazing? Isn't this so much better than the book? Listen to this. And then I was like, okay, now I'm going to sell it. So then I called up the publisher, and I pretended to be a producing company, and I was looking for the rights. And this is back in the days where you had like no internet. Right. You had to like find the number through the library. And
when they had libraries.
And rotary phone, and I'm in the kitchen and dialing, and then I get the number of the publisher, and then they refer me to the agent, and I call the agent, and I like concoct the story. It gets bigger, and now I'm like a European company, and I'm really fascinated by this book, and we want the rights. And so then he gives me William Goldman's number. He's like, well, you better talk to Bill. And I was like, and so I'm like, you dial like 6 times and I keep hanging up. I was too gushing sweat. And then this is back in the day of answering machines. And I'm saying, this guy is so rich and famous, he's got to have an answering machine. So I wrote out this really beautiful, elegant little speech. And then I'm like, it's ringing. And then like guy picks up the phone and is like, hello. And I'm like, hello, I'm looking for Bill Goldman. And he's like, yeah, this is Bill. And then I'm like, well, I'm a producer. I won't mention the rights of Princess Bride. And he's like, I wrote a script for Princess Bride. If it's going to sell, it's going to be mine. I don't know how you got this number. Click. I was like, oh. And I just realized 4 months down the drain because I didn't have the rights. So, lesson
young
to you
writers.
All.
Young
yes. writers.
Yes.
First, procure the rights.
But just keep going. I mean, whenever you finish something, start the next thing. Don't worry about what's going to happen to it. Writers always be writing, always.
Yeah.
And doing.
Yeah, make movies. You can make movie for nothing nowadays. I mean, back when we were young, it's like you see a camera, but oh my god,
It's a camera. Can I touch it?
Yeah. No, you can't.
I first want to start by saying that as one of the hundreds of PAs on Jupiter Ascending, thanks for bringing production to Chicago.
Well done, sir.
Well done.
Fine work.
It was a wonderful experience. There are several questions I want to ask, but I'm only going to ask the one that I know my girlfriend will kill me if I don't ask. And that is about the Plastic Man movie. How did that come about, and what ultimately happened with that?
Haunting us.
We got a three-picture writing deal for Warner Brothers, and that became one of the projects. I can't even remember what the other ones were. We wrote another script called The Business.
The Business.
And I think we parlayed one of our rewrites of something. And that was funny. We met Steven Spielberg for the first time in some story meeting. Yeah. And we were getting ready to shoot Bound. And they gave us a bunch of crazy story moments, and we're like, hi, Steven. How are you? And he's like, I hear you're going to start, you're going to make your first picture. And I was like, do you have any advice for us? And he's like, wear comfortable shoes. It was good advice, though. Yeah. I don't know. Plastic Man came, we sort of, there was this movie Mask 2 was supposed to come out, and we were like, we just got to write a better script than Mask 2.
Yeah. It probably isn't very hard.
Well, we thought it was such a funny thing. You would have this guy, his name is Plastic Man. It was kind of the beginning of the environmental, sort of aggressive environmental movement. And we're like, what? It's obvious. You make him an environmental guy, and he becomes all plastic, and he's like, oh, good.
My pee's not biodegradable. That was one of our
big gag.
He comes out of the bathroom, and he has a beaker full of his pee, and it's like
plastic.
Why didn't they want to make this movie?
Yeah, right. I know.
It's fantastic. I don't know. It's over there. They have it. It was really, when we wrote it, there wasn't enough CG, hadn't come along enough, and we actually had our villain became Plastic Man as well, and basically the whole world was becoming his massive chemical plant was becoming plastic, and so we were like two rubber guys fighting in a rubber room. So it would have cost too much, I think, at the time. And
we loved the idea of a guy who loved AstroTurf, like the idea that AstroTurf was something that was to be a valued, beautiful, aesthetically perfect product, because it never changed. It was always perfect.
It's out there for somebody to take the reins.
Some brave soul.
Carnivore. Did that turn into a film?
No.
It didn't. I read that script when I was at school, and I loved that script. Eat the Rich, yeah. The other thing, too, is you should read more scripts. Everybody should be reading scripts, like a ton of scripts, and you'll find some things that have never been produced, and you'll, it's amazing. I loved Carnivore. I thought it was such a fantastic, like smart, funny script.
Hey guys, my original question was actually taken earlier, so I was going to ask the V for Vendetta one, but I guess my new one would be, what's the difference between writing for a movie just to write it, rather than writing for you guys to direct it, like something like V for Vendetta versus like Cloud Atlas?
Well, Vendetta we were involved in. Have we written things that we haven't been involved in?
Yeah.
Assassins.
Unforgettable, we did some drafts. I don't know. It's probably easier to write for somebody else because you don't have to worry about how you're going to shoot it. Like, if you put in too much crazy stuff, you're like,
why did we write this?
right.
Let's shoot. I don't want to shoot this, so it's easier probably to write for somebody else.
Okay, next. And
how y'all doing? Thank you for coming out tonight. I just have one question. Like, when you're younger, what other directors did you use to like look for in terms of inspiration for your films? Like, what other directors did you look up to?
The list is long because we watch so many movies. So we could fill out the next 10 minutes. Movies that had a huge impact, though, at that time period were certainly Kubrick's movies were giant for us. 2001 and Clockwork Orange were just gigantic, huge effect on us.
John Borman, like, you know, Excalibur had a big effect on me when I was a kid. You know, Hitchcock, you know, our mom wouldn't let us see Psycho, so we would sneak onto our black and white TV that the channel didn't, you have to put the channel between the two channels for
right,
it to work.
Right. On TV, remember on TV? Yeah. That like first, I just remember that. That's funny. Are there any, I mean, the Matrix is so very tied to, in a way, technology. I mean, the way it was made. Are there any films that you really admired that you look to that had that kind of impact? Because when Star Wars came out in 77, it was, groundbreaking stuff. And it was such a different experience back then going to a movie. That's the thing that I try to tell the students. Like, I just don't think they can understand when I say I saw Star Wars I was in the front row on the floor because it was so packed. And it took me an hour just to get into the theater because remember the lines
were. Yeah, it was crazy.
But it was the energy in the room, in this giant theater, is so different. It was so different than seeing films today. It's just such a different, it seems as though films are getting more, the experience is more, like we were talking about 3D, it's more like it's just you. Because back home, most people have big TVs anyway, and they're kind of used to watching their, pausing it and doing this. And the theater experience now is kind of almost imitating that. It's just a different.
No, it's always complicated. It's like generational. What they get excited about is slightly different or has slight variation to it. I mean, when we saw Star Wars and we got into that, it was exciting and the buzz and the electricity and it was fun and there was something that was felt fresh about it. But what was interesting is that I also saw 2001, slightly before Star Wars, and 2001 was an important film for me because I didn't understand it when I saw it. And I was just a little kid. Our dad had taken me, and I was so frustrated by the movie. I kind of hated the movie when I first saw it. I was like, what is that stupid black thing? And then I was in the parking lot, and I was like, the way a kid gets frustrated. And my dad was like, what? And I was like, this movie was stupid. And I was like, I didn't get what was that black thing? And he said this thing where he said, oh, that's a symbol. And I was like, what? And I kind of like knew what the word was, but then suddenly I had a visual understanding of what the word was. I was like, a symbol of what? And he said, it's kind of like a symbol for the consciousness of God. And I was like, I didn't even understand what that meant, but it sounded amazing. And it sounded like God. And then you were like, oh. And so then I asked him to take me back to see it again. Mm-hmm. And I saw it again. And then whenever I saw the symbol, I thought of like, God. And it made more sense to me suddenly. Mm-hmm. And this was like a strange phenomenon that you could suddenly look at something and then have different eyes and see it again and understand it in a completely different way. Right. And that is not true for something like Star Wars.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, definitely.
You see Star Wars, and then you see it again, and it's the same. Mm-hmm. And it's the same. Mm-hmm. And then the only thing that happens is your relationship to the excitement diminishes.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And that's, I think, the difference between entertainment and art.
Right, for sure.
Well, you also have a nostalgic sense to it. That's what changes as well. You're like looking through it through your own personal history and your kids'
it
eyes
has an
looking
emotion.
At the movie.
Yeah.
Right, right. Right. I just remember seeing Apocalypse Now when it came out to the theaters. And you remember there was a theater in Northbrook, I think it was Eden's Theater. It was
huge.
And I got to see, I mean, I must have been, was it 79, I think it came out? Mm. And, I was 11, 12. And
pretty violent.
And my dad was great. My dad was like, he would buy us tickets and let us go. Like, we saw Papillon, all these movies that we probably shouldn't see. And it was like, yeah, go see Papillon. And he'd just go hang out in the car and watching people's heads get cut off, and I'd be like, he's like, how's the movie? He's like, oh, it's great. This guy gets his head cut off. It's like, yeah, it's cool. So and I remember seeing Apocalypse Now in at Eden's Theater with another friend of mine and just being like, it's just such an immersive, I mean, when you're that young too, and you're so, because that was a film to me that I just was mm-hmm. like, I didn't get it totally. I didn't mm-hmm. understand it. And, you know, as I grew up and I started going back to it, I would go back to it and see different things, especially when you go back to a film and you're older, you're kind of a different person, the film resonates in a totally different way for you.
That movie is one of my favorite ones to talk about because it's changed so much in my understanding of it or my unpacking or my relationship with it, because when I started, it was like, oh my God, it was so disturbing. Mm-hmm. But then as I got older, I began to understand more about aesthetics mm-hmm. and intent and artistic intent. And you realize, I would urge you to watch Apocalypse Now. Has everyone seen Apocalypse Now?
No.
Have you seen Conan the Barbarian? Yes. The original.
Yes. Schwarzenegger one.
Unbelievably, they're the same movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you would not believe this, mm-hmm. but watch them and actually watch the climaxes of the two movies because they're almost shot for shot. Mm-hmm. It's really weird. I mean, the chopping off of the head, the walking out, mm-hmm. the holding of the head, the crowd of worshipers, and the replacement of the father figure with this new figure.
Yeah.
It's both stories are pro-power movies, which is very interesting.
John Milius wrote both, right?
Yeah.
That's why, because this is why I always think that some of Coppola's work is not quite as rich as you'd like it to be if mm-hmm. he was more of a writer.
Right.
But he's basing the whole story on this guy's work who is a pro-power thinker, yeah. who thinks you must kill the father to become the new father. Mm-hmm. You must kill your dad. Mm-hmm. You know, John Milius has a complicated relationship with his father, but...
yeah.
And you see that Coppola is struggling with this pro-power script. There's a kind of interesting tension that's in mm-hmm. Apocalypse Now because he's like trying to make an anti-war movie, but right. in fact, it's actually a pro-war movie.
Yeah. I taught a class last year, year and a half ago. It was just 11 weeks on Apocalypse Now. I don't know how they let me do that, but it was like
awesome.
We watched every version of it, all the different cuts of it, and it was, to me, it was one of the funnest classes I've ever taught. Especially when you're getting students that haven't, I mean, just telling them that they invented surround sound on this film, mm-hmm. and it's like, I mean, it's amazing. I mean, it's amazing just the way they really pushed, you know, the envelope aesthetically, technologically, and all this kind of stuff. It's a really neat film. Let's get one more question, and then we've been talking a lot, so I'm sure they're tired.
Alrighty. Hi, guys. So I have an enormous respect for you as writers, and one of the biggest things that I have noticed is that you guys deal with such enormous high-concept stories and big, big, big ideas, and yet you have such well-drawn characters. And one thing that I find in a lot of films is that it's normally one or the other. And so as a writer myself, how do you find that balance of being able to bring in these big ideas and yet big characters that can meet?
Wow, that's very kind. Thank you. I don't know. We like ideas and we like emotion. So you want...
And we like spectacle as well.
Yeah. So we want... Every project is about that exact issue, finding the balance of them. And, you know, there's always this strange process where you begin with way more. You have way more ideas, and you have way more character, you have way more emotion, you have way more spectacle. And then you go through the process, and kind of discovering the movie is the process of whittling it down, finding as fine-tuned a balance as you can.
Yeah, on Cloud Atlas, I mean, that was different because we were working off of David Mitchell's book, but right around the same time that we were working on that, we were working on this project called Cobalt Neural 9, and that we started
cornering the market on 300-page scripts. And Cobalt Neural 9, particularly, I mean, David Mitchell's was because we, like, you know, basically took the book and, you know, did this first and then, you know, figured out how to make it into a movie and took the parts that we liked and didn't like. But CN9, we ended up distilling the script down from, like, 400. Okay, absolutely, only the best stuff is going in this. How many pages we got? 300. Jesus. So you almost have to overwrite everything. You have to over, you know, design everything and then just try to smash it in and jam it down into this smallest thing you can.
And there's always this one last level where you know it has to, it doesn't quite fit, doesn't quite work. There's this last level where you have to kill all your darlings.
Which baby is going to get
it? All the babies have to die.
Isn't that the whole filmmaking process, though? I mean, even like when you're shooting a film, it's like you get as much footage as you can, you get as many takes as you can, you get as many different angles as you can, then you're in the editing room, and you always, they say that if a film's going to work, it's your favorite shot is on the editing room floor at the end of the day.
There's something about chaos, though, of the shoot that's sort of forgiving. But when you're writing and when you're editing, there's this kind of like exacting process, and it's very bonding. So you write something and you're so precious. Oh my God, this line is so good.
Right.
Or then in an editorial, there was the last sort of round of little darlings killing with the three of us. It's kind of funny because you'd be like, oh yeah, I could cut that. And then Tom would be, oh. And then Tom would go, well, I could cut that.
Oh, right.
Over my dead body.
Okay, well, that's it for the questions. And I want to, before we say goodnight, do you have anything that you want to tell our students?
Wear comfortable shoes.
Wear comfortable shoes. It's good advice.